Good morning and happy new year.
Good morning, family.
Hi, Sister Sue.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, Deacon John. Happy birthday. Happy new year to you, sir.
Amen. Hey, Jonathan. Monique.
Good morning, good morning, family.
Amen.
Hey, Nikki. Good morning to you. Happy New Year.
Happy
not
new
birthday.
Year.
Happy New Year.
That's right. It was Jesus' birthday. Christmas time.
Amen.
Hi,
hallelujah.
John.
Good morning. Terry. Good morning. Hi, Melissa. God bless you. Good morning. Good morning. Sister Barbara.
Amen.
God bless
good
you.
Morning.
Hallelujah.
Hi, Tiff.
Amen. Hey, Tiff. We are still in the midst of joy and blessings, family.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes, we are. We right there in the midst of it. Seneca, God bless you, woman of God. Good morning. Good morning to you.
Amen.
Amen. Listen, guys, as you all are coming on, Happy New Year.
Amen.
To each and every one of you. make sure that you do me a favor. Would you share the link? Share the link this morning. And reach out, tag. I don't know why I always get that messed up. You tag people, right?
Tag people personally. Tag someone.
Amen. Tag someone and let them know that that we're going forth this morning. Amen.
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 Elder Annie
School. What's going on with this? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Y'all, let me know if you're having problems connecting this morning. Amen. We're mobile this morning. Amen. we're not in our normal spot. So let me know if there's problems with you guys connecting this morning. Good morning, Lady Jones, Sister Vanessa. Amen. Amen. God bless you all.
Amen.
Happy New Year.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's the year of grace and glory.
Hallelujah.
The full expression of the nature of God on display in our lives. Hallelujah. I'm excited about it.
Hallelujah.
Brother Lyons.
Amen. I don't know. It looked like something was.
Brother Francis.
Hey, Darian. God bless you, man of God. Hallelujah. Only showing two views.
Two views.
Yeah, I know something was going on. Only showing two views. I don't know what that means. You got to help me out, Tiff. You got to be a little more specific. I don't know what you're saying to me. A better still, call me on my wife's phone and tell me what you're talking about. I believe we're having some technical challenges this morning. Good morning. Good morning, Shaney Bree. Good morning, Gil. Amen. 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 You're showing on Facebook?
Yeah, I was able to share.
Okay. Okay. All right. Are we showing on YouTube, our YouTube family? Amen. We're going to just go ahead and do what the Lord has called us to do this morning. But hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look like they cut us off again.
Well, you know, I wouldn't know.
Yeah, I think, you know, I can tell. I can tell. It looked like. That's it. Y'all throw it in the comment section, believers. Throw it in the comment section that you are believers. I see YouTube. I don't know what's going on. Well, we're just gonna go forth and do what God has called us to do, and if we need to release what we release today.
What's your calling?
What you got?
The blood of Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Like. Okay, all right. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
YouTube is on?
Yeah, YouTube is on. Mm-hmm. She didn't tell me if Facebook was on. You watching on Facebook?
I'm watching on Facebook. Facebook is on.
Okay. All right, family. It is what it is, and we're going to work with it. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah and glory to God.
Hallelujah. Five words in the natural. 10,000 words in private. That's how we got to play. Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
All right, guys, make sure that you're reaching out. Make sure that you are sharing. And hallelujah. Hallelujah. I need the believers to put it out there in the comment section. If you are a believer, come on, if you are a believer, put it out there. Hallelujah. Just put it out there. I am a believer. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Amen. We greet each and every one of you today in LOVE and truly, truly, truly love it is. This Amen. Is the day that the Lord has made. And of course, yes, we are rejoicing. And that's it, Elder Brown. We are believers. Amen. And we are glad in it. Of course, I'm Amen. Bishop Herb Andrew. This is my wife, Elder Lynette. Y'all know that, of course. And Happy New Year. Happy Amen. New Year.
Happy New Year. Happy Welcome New- to 2022.
Amen. Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's going to be a great year, family. It really, really is. It is going to be a great year. And I just hope and pray that each and every one of you are standing on tiptoe anticipation to see what it is our God is going to manifest in our lives throughout this new year. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm excited about it. It is the year of grace and glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Full
Listen,
expression.
We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about that as we go a little further. But yes, this is a great year. Of course, God is doing great things, and we are excited about it. Again, Happy New Year to each and every one of you. It is our prayer that this is a prosperous year for you. I know that the blessings of God are resting upon your life, and they're going to continue to do so. Amen. Because all of our faith and all of our trust is in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And glory to his name. Why don't you pray for us, babe? And then we're going to jump right into what it is we have for today.
Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, how it is we love you, Lord God. We praise you and we bless your holy, most righteous name. Father, we are standing on tiptoe anticipation. Hallelujah. For what it is you have prepared for us this morning. We thank you, Lord God, in advance for the work that you're going to do in and through our lives. It's in the matchless name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Wanted to have my wife here today just to greet you all, of course, because we didn't do anything last week. Man, it's been a great week for us. We've been hanging out We've been hanging out with family, hanging out with them grandchildren, huh?
It doesn't get any better than that.
It really, really doesn't. We've been hanging out with the grandkids, and actually we're still here in Texas, even on today. But just wanted my wife to greet each and every one of you all, and you know, just let you all know, man, that this is gonna be a phenomenal year.
Look, amen.
Look, go ahead. Yes, go. You have something?
No, I was just in agreement with you. It is going to be a phenomenal year, and it has already started.
Yeah, I wanted to make mention of the fact that, of course, we're starting off this year. The first seven weeks of the year for us is always the 7 weeks to destiny.
Yes.
You know, the seventh Sunday for years, the seventh Sunday within our church family has always been considered Destiny Sunday. And these first seven weeks of the year, we consider them 7 weeks to destiny. So I do want to encourage each of y'all to make sure every Sunday, the people of God, y'all need to be with us. Y'all need to be with us right here on this platform and on Wednesdays when my wife and I share with our Grace Reloaded family check-in.
Amen.
The way that you start the year is so important because it sets the tone. It sets the tone for the remainder of the year. So I want to encourage you, family, to start the year sitting at the feet of Jesus, receiving all that God has for us in and through his word. Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Now, and also in these first 7 weeks, and I'll talk about this a little more at the end after the message, these first 7 weeks of the year, we're going to encourage you and we're going to challenge you. I know that we're in a challenging place right now, even as it relates to so many things happening in the world and even in our daily lives. But I'm going to be challenging each and every one of you to sow that first fruit seed. This is the year 2022. And the first fruit seed for this year will be $222. So we're going to encourage all families, of course, to do that. And we understand that even as we do so, man, the blessings of God, they just continue to pour in our lives.
Hallelujah.
And, you know, just overtake us to the place where we don't even have room enough to receive all that God is doing.
Absolutely.
Amen.
It's just an overflow.
Just an overflow.
It's an overflow. 2021. Amen.
So that's what we're looking forward to. And thank you, babe. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing with
us.
I'll
see you guys in the chat room.
Amen. 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 Now, listen, family. I do want to, you know, we're so excited. We're so blessed by all that God is doing in this season. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, people of God. Thank you so much for being who you are. And for allowing God, you know, to just have his way as you rest in him and as you enjoy the benefits and the blessings of being connected to the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, look, I want to, you know, I really believe and you know, y'all forgive me this morning if I just kind of, you know, go in different places, but I really want us to understand where we are, even in this season. Listen, before I do that, I need you guys to come in agreement with us in prayer for Elder Gail Van Doren, her husband, Deacon Pierre. He went home to be with the Lord on this morning, and she and I, we had an opportunity to speak, and we had an opportunity to talk, and she's strong. She is strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. But we as a church family, let's undergird her. And I'm calling all of my deacons, all of our deacons, please, 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 gentlemen, keep your ears and your eyes open as we prepare to celebrate his life and his legacy. And I know that it will be a tremendous blessing to both his family as well as his wife for all of our deacons to be in place to celebrate this man of God. So you'll hear more about that, probably have some more information for you on that this upcoming Wednesday, but if not, definitely on next Sunday. Now, as it relates to where we are, I really believe that this whole season of perfect prayers, we've been now just came out of it on December 31st, but for the last 50 days of the year of 2021, we've been sharing in what we have called 50 days of perfect prayers. And I really believe that this season of perfect prayers, I really believe that it has been a landmark season for our church family. And when I say that it's a landmark season for our church family, I believe that we will be able to look back on these 50 days and to tangibly see how it is that God changed the entire fabric of our ministry as we as believers begin to embrace the power of allowing the Holy Spirit to pray through us these perfect prayers, these prayers that we have learned strike the mark every single time. Every time we pray those perfect prayers, every time we're praying in tongues and allowing the Spirit to pray through us, man, every time we do that, we are striking the mark. And I believe that God has allowed us, he has allowed us to embrace this season as a landmark season. He has begun something within us that I believe God desires for us to not only be established in for a season, but I believe that God has called us to do this as a lifestyle. In other words, this whole practice of praying perfect prayers, I really believe that God has established this within us, and it is his desire that we continue to do this forever. I mean, from now until eternity, I believe that God is calling us to make use of these perfect prayers. As a matter of fact, we closed out last week reading Numbers chapter 10 and verse number 8. And in Numbers chapter 10 and verse number 8, the Bible says, "The sons of Aaron, the priests, shall blow the trumpets." Now we understand that blowing the trumpets is a metaphor or a type of praying in the spirit, of releasing supernatural utterance. And the word of God said to us in Numbers 10 and 8, that the sons of Aaron, the priests, they shall blow the trumpets, and these shall be to you as an ordinance forever. Y'all put that word in there in the comment section. Put the word forever. He says, these shall be to you an ordinance forever throughout your generations. So in other words, this whole idea of praying perfect prayers, this is not a practice that God has just established within us, but this is a practice, this is an ordinance that God wants us to continue in and to continue in it forever. And as we do so, you're gonna see just how important it is, because God has set us up. He really has, family. God has set us up. And I like to say it like this. I believe God, he has marked us. Listen to how I say this. He has marked us as a church family to be blessed. Hallelujah. This year, God has marked us for his blessings. This is going to be a phenomenal year. And this is not something that, you know, that I'm just coming up with to try to make you feel good, but man, God has strategically positioned us as a church family. He has marked us for his blessings, and it's all because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. Let me show it to you. Go if you would to John's Gospel chapter 10. John's Gospel chapter number 10. And the bottom line today, y'all, is when I have to stop, I'll stop, and I'll just pick it up whenever we have to. But look at this, John's Gospel chapter 10 and verses 27 and 28. Listen to what the word of God says. The Bible says, my sheep, this is Jesus speaking. He says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. They shall, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. Now pay close attention to that. Notice what the Lord says. Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. So according to John's Gospel, chapter number 10, there are three things that we can be certain of, even as we move into this year of 2022, as we flow and as we operate as the sheep of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There are three things right there in that verse that we as sheep can be certain of. And the amazing thing about it is, as I meditated on this, I discovered that all three are connected to us consistently praying in the Spirit. For instance, the Word of God says, my sheep hear my voice. Listen, he did not say that his sheep must learn to hear his voice. He did not say that his sheep may or may not hear his voice. According to the Word of God, if you have embraced Jesus as your Savior, he is now your shepherd, and we are his sheep. And one thing that we can be certain about as we move through this year of 2022, we can be certain about the fact that we as believers, we hear the voice of God. We hear his voice. Put that in the comment section as well. No, I hear his voice. Come on, declare it over your life. By faith, declare that you hear his voice, and that's based upon the authority of the word, because he says, my sheep hear my voice. Now understand, I said that all of this is connected to praying in the Spirit, because oftentimes when God speaks to us, he speaks to us in a still, small voice. But what we discovered even on last week, that praying in the Spirit, it causes us to be more sensitive to the promptings of the Holy Ghost. So when God is speaking and leading us from the inside out, because we pray in the Spirit, we have now become sensitive, and we now recognize his voice, because the truth of the matter is, as sheep, we hear his voice, and we hear it on a consistent basis. But not only did he say, we as sheep hear his voice, something else he says, that my sheep hear my voice and I know them. That word know is the word gnosko. That word gnosko, it means that he has intimate knowledge of us. So as we move forward throughout this year, it is so important that we understand that as the sheep of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we hear his voice. But we must also understand that the Father, he knows us, and he knows us intimately. Hallelujah. He knows everything about us. He has the number of hairs that is upon our head. And in my case, I'm lacking in that area, but he has numbered the hairs upon your head. So he knows everything about us. And we've discovered that praying in the Spirit is one of the ways that we grow in this intimacy with him. Y'all remember we talked about it last week. You got to understand that the Father knows us intimately. And one of the ways we grow in that intimacy is by praying in the Spirit. Because when we pray in the Spirit, we discovered that our Spirit and the Holy Spirit, they become one together in prayer. So three things that we must consistently be aware of throughout this year of 2022. We must remember that we as believers, I'm the pastor, but I'm not the only one hearing his voice. Are you guys hearing me today? No, you hear his voice. And you for whatever reason, you know, and one of those reasons is we have not been accustomed to praying in the Spirit so that we can become sensitive to the Holy Spirit's promptings. But as we do so, as we continue to do so, we are now learning that my spirit and God's spirit, they now have become so intimate in prayer that I can recognize his promptings. So I understand that I hear his voice. I understand that the Father knows us intimately. But then look at what he says. Still in verse 27, says, my sheep hear my voice. He says, I know them. And he says, they follow me. That's what I want to deal with right now. He says, they follow me. In other words, we hear the voice of God, the Father, our Heavenly Father, our God. He knows us intimately. And the Bible says we follow him. Y'all remember praying in the Spirit. As we pray in the Spirit, it releases these rivers of living water. One of the rivers we dealt with last week was the river of personal direction. This river that allows the Spirit to direct us from the inside out. I like to call it a right time, right place anointing. When we begin to pray in the Spirit consistently, you'll be amazed how it is that even when you don't realize it, you'll still yet be following God. Why? Because you know his voice. And a voice of a stranger, you'll never follow, because a voice of a stranger, according to John chapter 10, you don't know. So in this season, I really believe that where we are right now, and hear me, family, where we are right now in this moment, I believe that it is the result of us following Jesus without realizing or knowing where it was he was taking us. Hallelujah. We're in a good place, family. I'm not saying that we don't have challenges. I'm not saying that we don't have things coming against us. But the truth of the matter is we are in a fantastic place. And I believe that the place we're in right now, where we are right now at this present moment, I really believe that it's the result of us following Jesus without really knowing where he was taking us. Let's backtrack for a moment. Let's backtrack just for a moment, because the Bible says that the word says in Galatians. Well, before I deal with that, last year, let's go all the way back to the first sermon that was preached last year in 2021. In 2021, the first sermon that we preached in the year of 2021, the Lord had us to make the declaration that Jesus would be revealed to us at a greater level as our Redeemer. The Lord revealed to us that throughout that year of 2021, that we would gain revelation of Jesus as our Redeemer, as the one who has redeemed us from the curse of the law, as the one who has redeemed us from sickness, who has redeemed us from poverty, who has redeemed us from spiritual death, who has redeemed us from worry, from stress, from fear. So the Lord said to us at the beginning of 2021 that throughout that year, we would gain a greater revelation of Jesus as our Redeemer. And it's so wonderful, because we understand that we were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold, but we have been redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. But we also understood that the redemption in and of itself was not the end, but the redemption, we've learned, was a means to get us to an end. Galatians chapter number 3, verses 13 and 14 talks about how Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. And then the Bible says that he redeemed us from the curse of the law in order that the blessing of Abraham would come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus. In other words, stay with me, because I promise you, y'all, the Lord has set us up. No, I'm serious. The Lord has set us up. He has He revealed Jesus at a greater level to us as the Redeemer. And he did so that the blessing of Abram could rest upon us, the blessing of righteousness. He redeemed us so that we could become righteous. And the word of God tells us why, so that we could receive the promise of the Spirit by faith. Hallelujah. In other words, the redemption wasn't the end. The redemption, he redeemed us so he could make us righteous. You have to understand throughout this year, you have to understand throughout the rest of your being that because of the finished work of Jesus, you have been made righteous. I dare you to put that in the comment section, that I am righteous. Hallelujah. The Bible says it like this in Hebrews 10 and 14. The Bible says, by one man's offering, we have been perfected forever. Hallelujah. He says, by the offering that Jesus made, we have been perfected forever. So here it is. He redeemed us in order to make us righteous, in order that we could receive the promise of the Spirit. And we understand what the promise of the Spirit is. The promise of the Spirit is the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of praying in tongues. It is the ability to allow the Spirit of God to pray perfect prayers through us. So what are you saying, Bishop? I'm saying that Christ has redeemed us. He has redeemed us to make us righteous so we could receive the promise of the Spirit. And that's where we are now. We're coming off the heels of 50 days of perfect prayers, 50 days where we have intentionally allowed the Spirit to pray through us, knowing that he has been praying perfect prayers for us, for our family, for our businesses, for our finances, for every area of our lives. So now, where do we go from here? I said to us earlier that God did not bring us to this point. He did not establish us in this prayer gift in order that we do it for a season and stop. No, I believe that the practice that God has established us in, he established us within it, and it is his desire that we continue in it forever. Well, Bishop, I hear you, but I have the same question. And the question that I have is, according to God's word, where do we go from here? What comes next? Let me tell you what comes next. Isaiah chapter 60. Go there if you would. Isaiah chapter 60. And look at what the Bible says in verse number 1. I'm going to take my time with this. I'm going to take my time with this because it is so critical that you see this. It is so critical that you see that at this point, God has set us up. This year, God has marked us for his blessings. Y'all gotta receive that. I said, this year, God has marked us for his blessings. Now look at this again, because the word of God says in Isaiah chapter 60 and verse number 1, the word of God says, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. So I'm addressing the question, where do we, as a church family, where do we go from here? Where do we go on the heels of this season of praying perfect prayers? Well, I bless God, man. I bless God. We're such a blessed people. I'm such a blessed man of God. I have a great pastor in Bishop Darrell Brister, and I thank God for him, as well as the other pastors of the Beacon Light family of churches. And I thank God because this year, as a family of churches, we have determined that the Lord is challenging us to grow in grace. So as a family of churches, our mantra is the year of 2022, we are growing in grace. We are growing in grace. All of our Beacon Light churches, that's where we are, man. We are growing in grace. We are walking in the revelation that it is all about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Now we have to grow in it because there's a lot of stuff that religion has put in us that waters down what Jesus has done. But this year, as a family of churches, we are growing in grace. But man, over the last few months, I've been hearing something in my spirit. And I've been hearing for quite some time now, I've been hearing the Lord say that we as a people, we have now entered the season of manifested glory. I need y'all to get that. Notice what I said. The Lord spoke this in my spirit, and he spoke this in my spirit. I guess it was sometime around October, September, October is when I heard the Lord say that we have entered the season of manifested glory. Let me read Isaiah 60 again. He says, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you." He said, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord, it's not going to rise upon you, but the glory of the Lord, it is presently risen upon you." Verse 2 says, "For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you." I really believe, family, with everything that is within me, I really believe that we as a body of believers, we have entered the time of God's manifested glory. I believe that with everything that is within me. I believe that this year of 2022, I believe that this year, hallelujah, not only has God marked us for blessings, but I believe, family, that this year is a year of his manifested glory. 2022, you're going to experience the glory of the Lord like never before. Listen to me. Notice what he says. He says, "For behold, darkness shall cover the earth and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you and his glory will be seen upon you." In other words, his glory, this glory that is on you right now, this glory, it is best seen and it is best discovered in the midst of darkness. And family, I mean, we don't have to be real deep. We don't have to be real spiritual to understand that we are living in a dark time. We're living in a dark time. All you have to do is open your eyes and look around. But the awesome thing about it is the word of God says that darkness shall cover the earth. Deep darkness shall cover the people, but the Lord will rise upon you and his glory will be seen upon you. In other words, what God is saying is that the darker it gets in this world, the more things that are happening, COVID-19, challenges with the economy, all of the stuff that is we are dealing with in this time, the Lord says the darker it gets for the world, the more his glory is going to be seen in the lives of his people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now understand when we're talking about glory and I don't want this, you know, when you start talking about things like glory, if you're not careful, that could become a very nebulous term. It can become a term that we use without any understanding. But my wife mentioned earlier how it is that the glory is literally the full manifestation of God on display. In other words, this is what God is saying to you. This is what God is saying to each of us, that in the face of the darkness that is covering this earth, we can expect the full nature of God. We can expect his glory, the full nature of God, to be on display in each and every one of our personal lives. Hallelujah. No. Man, if you think I'm trying to get a response, you know, just trying to say something to make you feel good, you, come on, y'all, you don't recognize where I am in this season. No, I am not giving you something to try to hype you up. I'm telling you what thus says the Lord. And the Lord says to you, the Lord says about your family, the Lord says concerning your business, the Lord says concerning any and everything that you are involved in, the Lord says the darker it gets in this world, the more negativity that we see in this world, he says that we as believers, we can expect the glory of God. We can expect the full nature of God to be on display in each and every one of our personal lives. Hallelujah. In other words, in the midst of this COVID, in the midst of this COVID-19, because it is running rampant, it's all over the place again. And God says that one, a part of my nature is I, God, am a protector. So we, because it's dark in the world, the glory of God, his protection will be seen on our lives like never ever before. Even if by chance someone does get sick, well, God's nature is that of a healer. Hallelujah. So if you do by chance get sick, whether it's COVID, whether it's cancer, whether it's anything, understand that the darker it gets in the world, the brighter his glory is going to show, the full nature of God. Part of his nature is that he's a healer. So if sickness visits your house, you can expect healing to manifest. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Another part of his nature, God is a provider. He's a provider. That's just who he is. He is a provider. And in the midst of the challenges in the economy, hallelujah, God says that my full nature will be on display in your life. Others may be struggling, trying to figure out how they're going to get to this point and how they're going to take care of that. But my nature as a provider is going to manifest in your life. Hallelujah. We, as a body of believers, we have been marked out for the blessings of our God. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Now, hear me today. Hear me today. Because I'm pulling this, and I'm pulling it from, of course, from Isaiah chapter 60. And individuals who know me, Elder Margie Scott, she reached out to me earlier this morning. And Elder Margie Scott and I, a couple years ago, when we were having our 12 noon in-person Bible studies, after Bible study, you know, we would talk and share certain things. And I could remember standing under our portiche, sharing with her Isaiah chapter 60, because the Lord dropped that in my spirit. Years ago, the Lord dropped that in my spirit. And I've just been meditating on that over the years. I've been meditating on that at different times. The Lord would lead me to pray that over my own life. And, you know, I had to question God because I said, God, I hear what you're saying. I hear you saying that this is the season to arise and shine because your glory will be seen upon us. But God, I've been meditating on that for years. I said, how can I know for certain that the season we're talking about is the season we're in right now? Because I've been meditating on that for at least 5 years that I can remember. So why wasn't that season 3 years ago, 4 years ago? How can I know, God, that the season I am declaring over your people is the season that we are in at this present moment? And the Lord, as I questioned him, the Lord told me, he said, go back to Isaiah 59. And so I did. And let's go there for a moment. Isaiah chapter 59. Oh, yeah. This is the year, y'all. This is the year of grace and glory. His grace is manifesting in our lives, and now his glory will be seen, and it will be seen brighter than ever, because the darker it gets for this world, the brighter it is getting for those of us who are connected to our Savior, Jesus Christ. Look at Isaiah 59. Isaiah 59, look at verse number 1 and verse number 2, because in these particular verses, Isaiah is prophesying concerning the dark times that would come. And truly, I believe that the times he was prophesying about, I really believe that time is right now. Because look at what he says. He says in verse number 1, he says, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that he cannot save, nor his ear heavy that he cannot hear. In other words, he says, don't get it twisted in the midst of the dark times that we are in. He said, don't get it twisted. He says, there's absolutely nothing wrong with our God. You know, because a lot of people, they look at everything that's happening in the world today, and a lot of people want to ask the question, well, where is God? Why is God not intervening, and so forth? Well, Isaiah, when prophesying about these dark times, Isaiah made it clear that there is absolutely nothing wrong with our God. Isaiah says, the hand of the Lord is not shortened that he cannot save, neither is his ear heavy that he cannot hear. In other words, he says, there ain't nothing wrong with God. He says, here's the issue in verse number 2. He says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear you. In other words, he says, concerning these dark times, Isaiah says, look, nothing's wrong with God. His arms or his hand is not shortened that he cannot save. His ear is not heavy that he cannot hear. He says the issue is that iniquities and sin have separated you from God and has caused God to hide his face and to cover his ears concerning your prayers. So there's nothing wrong with God, but he says here in his prophecy, Isaiah does, that sin has caused a separation between man and God. And understand something, y'all, we serve a holy God. And because we serve a holy God, he cannot stand sin. Hallelujah. And understand that sin is what caused the separation between man and God. And the only answer, please hear this, the only answer to the separation that's been created by sin is the Redeemer coming to Zion. Stay with me. Only answer to this problem that Isaiah was seeing was a Redeemer coming to Zion. We're in Isaiah 59. Drop down to verse 20 and I'll show it to you. He says in verse number 20, read the rest of that, verses 3 through 19. Read that in your own time. But I'm just trying to give you as much as I can in the time that I've been allotted. But understand, Isaiah says there's nothing wrong with God. Understand that sin has caused a separation between man and God. And the only answer to the separation created by sin is the Redeemer, Jesus Christ himself, coming to Zion. Hallelujah. He says it in verse number 20, the Redeemer will come to Zion. Remember, Isaiah is prophesying. He's looking off in the future. And Isaiah says, I see a separation between man and God. It's a separation that has not been created by God, but it is a separation that has been created by sin. But then he says that the Redeemer will come to Zion. In other words, the answer to this separation is the Redeemer coming to Zion. He says the Redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. In other words, he says the first thing that has to happen to get man back to the place that he has, that he needs to be with God, is man needs a Redeemer. Who is our Redeemer? Jesus Christ. Wait a minute. God told us at the beginning of last year, God told us that in the year of 2021, we would gain a greater revelation of Jesus, not just as our Savior, but as our Redeemer. Come on, y'all. Come on. Come on. You got to see that. You got to see that. And he says, the Redeemer coming to Zion. I don't have time to deal with Zion, but Zion is the place of grace. When the Redeemer comes to Zion, that in and of itself, it takes care of and it heals the separation that sin has created between man and God. In other words, because we have a revelation of Jesus as our Redeemer, he's redeemed us from the curse of the law. Because we have that revelation, we understand the Redeemer, he's not coming to Zion. He's already here. He's already here. But what happens once the Redeemer comes to Zion? Well, look at verse 21. He says, as for me, says the Lord, this is my covenant with them. In other words, once the Redeemer comes, in comes another covenant. And he says, in this covenant, he says, my spirit who is upon you and my words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your descendants, nor from the mouth of your descendants, says the Lord, from this time forever. Wait a minute. Holy Spirit, help me with this. The Bible says that there was a separation. Isaiah, look into the future. There's a separation between man and God, a separation that is created by sin. The solution to that separation is the Redeemer coming to Zion, Jesus coming to Zion. And now the Lord says to us at the beginning of last year that I am revealing to you, I am giving this church family a greater revelation of Jesus as a Redeemer. Hallelujah. The Redeemer is in Zion. But we understood that the redemption was not the end. The redemption, he redeemed us from the curse of the law so that he could make us righteous. He redeemed us to make us righteous so that we could receive the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Well, wait a minute. He says here in Isaiah, after the Redeemer comes, in verse number 20, a new covenant is established. And in this new covenant, he says, my spirit will be who is upon you, and the words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth. Well, I have a question for you. When is God's spirit upon us? And when is his spirit upon us and his words put in our mouth? Well, I'll tell you when. Let the Bible answer it. In Acts chapter 4, the Bible says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. Verse 5 says, for truly John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So, and then in chapter 2, in verse 4, he says, and they were all, when they were sitting in the upper room, waiting for this to manifest, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. They were all baptized with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. In other words, the Redeemer comes. And because the Redeemer comes, the Spirit can come upon us. I'm in Isaiah, and he says, when the Spirit came upon us, he says, the words I put in your mouth, they shall not depart. Don't let them depart from your mouth. Don't let them depart from your children's mouth. Don't let them depart from your children's children's mouth. In other words, you be filled with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Cause your children to be filled with the Spirit, and cause your grandbabies to be filled with the Spirit. Don't let his words, because when we're baptized with the Holy Spirit, we pray in tongues as the Spirit gives us utterance. We don't pray our words, we're praying his words. And he says, after the Redeemer is manifested, he says, the Holy Spirit comes upon you. I'm going to put some words in your mouth. And he says, don't let those words depart from your mouth. And that is how chapter 59 ends. And he says, when you do not allow those words to depart from your mouth, notice what comes next. After Isaiah 59 and verse 21, when we make the decision to not allow these words that God has put in our mouth, this supernatural utterance that we have because the Spirit has come upon us through the baptism of the Holy Spirit, if we can just make up in our mind that these words shall not depart from our mouth, what's the next thing that happened? Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1, he says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Family, we didn't set this up. I could not have put this together. All I did was say what God told me to say in January of 2021. I know God told me that he was revealing himself to us at a greater level as our Redeemer. And throughout the year, he taught us that the redemption was not the end. The redemption was in order to make you righteous so that you could receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And now Isaiah says sin had separated man from God. The only answer to sin was a Redeemer. The Redeemer has come to Zion. And he says, once the Redeemer comes to Zion, what happens? I make a new covenant with you. And the covenant that I make with you is I will put my Spirit upon you. That's the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he says, when I put my Spirit upon you, I'm going to put some words in your mouth. And he says, whatever you do, do not allow those words to depart from your mouth. In other words, he's saying, keep the music playing, keep blowing your spiritual trumpet, keep playing your spiritual harp. And he says, as you do not allow the words to depart from your mouth, he says, arise and shine, for the light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. If I be not a man of God, listen to me today, family. We have entered the time of God's manifested glory. This right now, the time that we are in right now, because of Jesus, our Redeemer, because we have put our faith and trust in him as our Redeemer, the time when the full nature of God will be on display in every one of our lives, that time has come. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. So in this season, you can't be tripping. You can't be tripping because of what you see happening in everybody else's life. You can't be tripping because of what you see happening around you. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand. But I decree and declare on the authority of God's word that it shall not come near you. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Now, watch this, because I made the statement that this year, God has marked us for his blessings. I said this year, God has marked us for his blessings. And you have to understand why. Look at verse 3. I'm still in Isaiah chapter 60. He says in verse 2, for behold, darkness shall cover the earth and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you and his glory will be seen upon you. And then in verse 3, he says, and the Gentiles shall come to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising. In other words, he has marked us for blessings. He has marked us for blessings. And as his glory is upon us, as people see how dark it is in the world, but they see that you're still healthy, whole, and healed. They see that your family is protected. They see that your family is provided for. They see that when you go through challenges like everybody else, you still have a peace of God that surpasses understanding. When people see the glory of God, the full nature of God manifesting in your life, what is going to happen? Gentiles are going to come to that light. In other words, people are going to be drawn to you to want to know what makes you so different. And you, because you understand the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you won't operate with religious arrogance talking about, well, you know, I fasted for 40 days and I did this and I did that. No, when they come to you wanting to know, how is it that you're protected, you're provided for, you have peace, your family is so strong, how is it that this is happening in the midst of the dark times? You'll point them to the real light. You'll tell them, you'll let your light so shine that they see what's happening in your life, but Jesus will get all of the glory. Hallelujah. It's all about us being a witness. You remember? He says concerning the Holy Spirit coming upon us, and you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come up on you. That's what Isaiah said. He said, my spirit, which is up on you. Hallelujah. And my words, which I put in your mouth. So he says, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses. In other words, the reason God has marked you for blessings is because he desires for you to be a witness. No. I didn't say to go out and witness. You could do that if you want to. But in this season, God is calling you to be a witness. And as those words stay in your mouth, that's why I truly believe, family, that God, our Heavenly Father, I truly believe that this practice, this gift that he has given unto us, He did not establish this within us for a season, but this is something that he wants us to continue in forever, because he says, when these words do not depart from your mouth, from the mouth of your descendants and your descendants' descendants, he says, you can arise and shine, for the glory of the Lord is upon you. His full manifestation of who God is getting ready to shine on your life. Hallelujah. You know what the Bible says? I'll give you this and I'll wrap it up for today. You know what the Bible says concerning Jesus? The Bible says that Jesus, watch this. The Bible says that Jesus is the glory of God. Check it out in John's Gospel, chapter number 1. The Bible calls him, you know, it said, we have seen the glory. He came to his own and they denied him. And then it talks about how he is the glory of our God. Jesus is literally the glory of the Lord. I told you, you're marked. This year, God has marked us for blessings. Jesus, he's the glory of the Lord. Jesus is the full manifestation of who our God is. If you want to know something about God, look at Jesus. You want to know how God loves? Look at Jesus. You want to know who God will heal? Look at Jesus. You want to know who God will bless? Look at Jesus. Hallelujah. Because Jesus is the full manifestation of our God on display. But now look at the first sermon that Jesus, the glory of the Lord, look at what he said in his first recorded sermon. The first sermon recorded by Jesus, all it did was speak blessings over the people. Jesus, the glory of God, he opens up his first recorded sermon by blessing us. Hallelujah. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that this year God has marked us for blessings, but it's not just about us. It's about us being a witness. He wants this glory to be upon our life so individuals can see what our God is doing and the power that he has in the midst of challenges. I'll read one other passage of scripture and then we'll be done. Look at Psalm 67 in verse number 1. The Bible says, God be merciful to us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us. Now that word merciful is a very interesting word, because in the Hebrew it's the word hesed. Hesed literally means, it actually means grace. So when he says God be merciful, what he's actually saying is God be gracious to us and bless us and cause your face to shine upon us. That's his glory. The psalmist says, God, be gracious to me and bless me and cause your glory to shine upon me. And look at what he says in verse 2. It's not so that I could have it going on, but he says in verse 2, that your way may be known on the earth and your salvation among all nations. In other words, God, through the psalmist is saying, God, as you are gracious to me, and as you are blessing me, and as your glory is being released over my life, he says, individuals will see me, but your way will be known on the earth. They will see me and they will know that in the midst of darkness, you are light. They will see me and they will know in the midst of sickness, you are health. They will see me, I'm talking about us, y'all, and they will know that in the midst of depression, you are peace. Hallelujah. And he says that your way may be known on the earth and your salvation may be known among all nations. That word salvation is the word Yeshua. Yeshua is a Hebrew name for Jesus. In other words, God is saying to us, family, as his glory and as his blessings remained on us, people will come to know God for who he really is. God is a healer. God is a deliverer. God gives peace in the midst of worry and stress and depression. God is light in darkness. He says, not only will people begin to know my ways, but they will also begin to know my salvation, Yeshua, Jesus. As the glory, come on, lay your hands on yourself right where you are and declare, his glory is upon me. Come on, right where you are, declare it. His glory is upon me. His glory is upon me. And as his glory is manifesting in this season, people are going to learn about God by looking at your life. You are a living epistle read of men. And when they see you, they will know the devil is a liar. God is exalted and every enemy is defeated. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We bless you for this year. Yes, we are growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus. But we thank you, Father, for the year of 2022. For we declare that according to your word, you have marked us in this season for your blessings. According to your word, Father, we have entered the season of grace and glory. We thank you that our job now is to simply make sure that as the Spirit is upon us, that your words, your supernatural utterance remains in our mouth. And as we do so, in the midst of darkness, your glory shall manifest like never, ever before. We thank you. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Grab your communion elements. Let's seal this today. I just believe, family, I believe that as we allow his supernatural utterance to remain in our mouths, just as Abimelech said to Isaac, people are going to say it concerning you, your family, your co-workers. Expect it. They're going to be coming up to you and they're going to say, I've been watching you. And I must confess that truly the Lord is with you. Father, we thank you even now for this wonderful privilege on this first Sunday of the year of 2022. We thank you for allowing us the privilege of enjoying this day, but enjoying it with the promise upon our lives. We thank you that because of the finished work of Jesus, we have been marked out in this season for blessings. And we thank you that because of his finished work, we have now entered this season of grace and glory. So we seal it this day, Father, with our covenant meal. And we thank you for on the night that Jesus himself was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He gave it to the disciples and he said, take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Go ahead and receive today. Expose, if you would, the wine. For the Bible says, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, said to his disciples, each of you drink from it. For this cup is the blood of the new covenant, the blood that is shed for many for the remission of sins. For as often as you do it in remembrance of me. Go ahead and receive today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody just go ahead and tell him thank you. Hallelujah. Family, we've been set up. We've been set up. I promise you, we've been set up to be blessed. We've been marked. This year, God has marked us for his blessings. Our job is to just keep allowing the Spirit to pray through us. Allow the Spirit who is upon us, in us, to pray through us. Allow his words to not depart from our mouth. And watch the glory. It is already risen upon you. Expect favor. Expect people to treat you differently. Hallelujah. And it's not because of you. It's because the glory of God is risen upon you. Hallelujah. If you're in agreement with that, show some sign, throw something in the comment section, do something to confirm that you are with us on that. Listen, I mentioned earlier, we're getting ready to give unto the Lord because we understand that it is in and through our giving that We continue to position ourselves to receive all of the tremendous blessings that God has released in our lives. Maybe I'll deal with this a little bit, maybe on Wednesday, because of course, we're going to continue. We're going to continue, close out our money management workshop on this Wednesday in the midst of our Grace Reloaded broadcast. But in the midst of that as well, I think I may share just a few scriptures to help you guys as it relates to the first fruit seed. As we give the tithe unto the Lord, we understand that 10 cents out of every dollar, that belongs to Him. That belongs to Him. It's never the ceiling where we end. It's always our beginning point. But then we give a liberal offering because the Bible says the liberal soul shall be made fat. If my wife and I, if we are a blessing to you, sow seed into our life, pastor's love gift. And of course, God will always honor you with a prophet's reward. And then finally, of course, I do want to encourage all of you, every family. I want to encourage you to sow that sacrificial seed of $222 as a first fruit seed offering. I'll deal with that a little bit on Wednesday, just so that you guys will understand that this is all biblical. It's all according to the word of God, because the Bible says there in the book of Nehemiah that there were three things that were stored in the storehouse of the Lord, and that was the tithe and the offerings and also the first fruit. So we, of course, we give a tithe, we give offerings all year long, but we challenge you at the beginning of each year to sow that first fruit seed of $222. So if you would do that, of course, you can do it by just simply BLOHTBLOHO, text that to 28950. You can use the Cash App, $BLHOMA, or of course our website, www.beaconlightofhoma.org, or you can drop it in the mail, 4325 West Park Avenue, Gray, Louisiana, 70359. However you do it, make sure that you do get some seed in the ground. Amen. Amen and amen. And you watch, God is going to continue to do what He's been doing, and that is blessing us abundantly above that which we can ever think or even imagine. I don't know what happened earlier, guys. I couldn't see your comments and all of that good stuff. I hope and pray that you receive this word today. It was not designed to excite you. It was designed to inform you. It was designed to reveal to you where we really are. And we are in a season and a time of God's manifested glory. I promise you, if I be not a man of God, you can expect the year of 2022 to be the year of God's grace and the year of God's glory. Love you guys. I really do. I love you guys. Thank you so much for connecting. Continue to pray for Elder Gail and her family, and you'll get some more information as we move forward as it relates to the homegoing celebration of Deacon Pierre Van Doren. I love you, family. Thank you again for connecting this morning. Happy New Year to each and every one of you. This is going to be one of the best years of your life. Why don't you throw it in the comment section? I received that. Hallelujah. Go in peace, and we'll connect with you on this upcoming Wednesday.